Hey, followers, this is your boy, Movie Maker Doug 55. Today, I have a very special guest on my channel who is involved in both industries I want to be a part of, the film industry and the racing industry. His name is Tomy Drissi. What's up, Tomy?
How's it going, everybody? Thanks for having me.
No problem. So tell my fan base what you're known for.
Well, I'm known for a lot of things, but hopefully for being a good driver and I am in the film industry. I'm in the creative advertising. So on that note, the creative advertising part is we get people to go to the movies, the big theater opening, big blockbuster stuff. And so when you walk into a theater, we promote the movies. While you're there seeing a movie, we're there a few months ahead of time promoting movies that are going to come out, you know, a few months later. And we do experiential and stuff like that. Then as far as race car driving is concerned, you know, I started in the Trans Am series. That's all I knew. It's all I watched on TV, and I was a big fan of it. And I said, maybe one day I could do that. And, you know, I've done pretty well in Trans Am. And then once in a blue moon, I was able to pick up a ride in the road course races in NASCAR. You know, some of the smaller teams, but I felt I did a pretty good job, you know, for with the equipment that was given to us. And then I had some success in IMSA in the LMPC program, the prototype program.
That's really incredible. A very incredible sports car career, it sounds like. Did you win any championships at all?
Yeah, well, I won a championship in Trans Am in 2009. And then, you know, I always look back sometimes. Kyle Marcelli, who's a good dear friend and was a driver with me sharing the LMPC ride. If we had a deal, and I guess the deal was only for a half a year as far as the team owner was concerned. And I thought maybe we'd run the whole year together, and then we got split up. But, you know, going into the, I think we did like half the season, we would have won a championship in that too. We won some races together. And later on the following year and the year after, I won some races, and a real big one. I won Fob and Gist, the three of us with on bar one, we won a real big race. We won the last ever open cockpit prototype race in an LMPC car at the 10-hour Petit Le Mans at Road Atlanta.
Wow, that's really cool.
That was a good one.
Yeah. So
all wins are good, but some of them are a little more special than others, you know?
Yeah, like there are some drivers that could say that winning a championship is good, but winning a Daytona 500, you know, there's some races that are big.
I think the Daytona 500, I guess if I make my comparison in sports car racing is the Long Beach Grand Prix or Monaco, right?
Yeah.
So I'm one out of two. I won the Long Beach Grand Prix, so that was a good one in Trans Am.
That's really cool. What was winning that race like?
First of all, it was my first professional win. It was my first win in Trans Am, and I won Rookie of the Year in. I won Rookie of the Year, my first year, obviously Rookie of the Year, in 1999. And the very next year, I won my first race at the Long Beach Grand Prix.
That's really cool. So when did you make your first start?
In 99, I started. It was my first professional race in Trans Am. I did a little vintage racing. I drive some other people's old cars. I had a couple of old cars that I raced. I didn't know about SCCA. I didn't know about amateur racing or, you know, GT1 racing. I went right from vintage racing and got thrown to the lions and went Trans Am racing.
Oh, okay. So did you begin your career in advertising then before racing?
I've always been a racer. It wasn't professional, it wasn't organized, but my first experience in racing was my my first car when I was 16 years old. From the time from 16 to my early 20s, I would go up to the Hollywood Hills, you know, in the canyons, Mulholland, Canaan Dune, Topanga, you know. But I got put in the back seat of this car that was black and white, and they scared me enough that I kind of had to wait for a while before I got racing again legitimately.
Okay.
I got put in the back seat without the cuffs. They never took me in, but they scared the crap out of me sitting there a couple times in that back seat. So
how did you start your business about advertising?
You know, long story short, I was working for a smaller little company, and they provided a service to another bigger company that designed movie posters. And I was, I didn't have the best car to drive a messenger. So I was a walker and a runner, literally on my 2 feet, right? Mm-hmm. And so I would walk and run to a few places, right local, a few blocks away from this shop. And so I hit this guy up, Tony Seiniger, and he's my friend since. I started working in it when I was 18 years old, I think barely 18 years old. And it just kind of progressed in me understanding the business. And then years later, I started my own. I went back to school, got my marketing degree, and I started my own company doing in theater marketing, advertising, and big experiential advertising, creative advertising.
Really interesting. That's really cool. So have you, being that you're an advertising agent or something like that, have you ever met any film stars at all?
Through my business, not really, but living in Hollywood, yes, I have. Out and about, sometimes here and there, being introduced to somebody here and there or spotting somebody. But, you know, you live in Hollywood, and there are some people in the business that actually live in Hollywood.
Yeah. Like, who have you met?
Oh, gosh. One of the coolest guys I met just for the moment was Brad Pitt. Mm. That was pretty cool. He was very nice to me, was very nice to my friends, and just seemed like a stand-up guy.
Good to hear. So that's really cool. Brad Pitt is a great actor. I remember him in that movie about Troy.
Oh, yeah. I think one of the greatest, I don't even know some of the younger folks, one of the greatest experiences I had meeting somebody in the industry, I pulled up to a red light on Sunset Boulevard, and I'm rocking to some song all by myself in my own world. And I'm usually better aware of kind of calming down when I get to a red light. But I don't know how old I was, but anyway. And I just come from a run down Sunset from the beach, down Sunset Boulevard. And I get a little closer to Hollywood, to the Strip. And I kind of in an embarrassing way, realized I was rocking to it. And I felt somebody in the car next to me in the back seat staring, looking at me. And I gave a smile because I recognized who the person was right away. And he put his big hand up just like this, gave me a grin, because I guess I made him happy that I was kind of in a good mood. And it was Orson Welles. You know, and I thought, I went, oh, whoa, he was in the back seat of a suicide, something that he probably bought when he was younger and had a guy helping him drive, you know, maybe he was a little bit, you know, at the time, now I didn't want to drive anymore, but I'll just never forget that. That was pretty cool. Orson Welles.
Yeah, he's a legend.
Right?
Yeah, I think he created a lot of films that are in the Library of Congress as being culturally significant.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll have to look up those movies. But yeah, I think one of them, wasn't he involved in Citizen Kane at all?
Yes.
That's the one I think I was thinking of. Yeah, Citizen
Kane. I hope I'm right, but I think yes.
Yeah, no problem. But yeah, that's really incredible. So
I'm sure you'll correct me and give me a text and let me know. So
no problem. I'll let you know. But I think he was involved in Citizen Kane from what I've read. But yeah. So I'm just curious, this next one you don't have to answer if you don't wish, but I'm just curious, a few years back, due to circumstances that I won't bring up exactly, you were told by Trans Am officials that you couldn't return for a while until 2017. I'm just curious, what exactly did you do to keep yourself active?
That's a very fair question the way you asked it, and I appreciate it. I don't remember the exact year, but I did get suspended from Trans Am for the remainder of whatever year that I was racing that year for over aggressive driving. And it was pretty tough to deal with.
Yeah.
I obviously had my story. The other person had their story. And what people saw, you know, there was different, there was, you know, I got calls, I got really mean calls, and I got some really supportive calls. So, yeah. You know, you got to get, when something like that happens, you know, you got to get through that first phase of it. And then, it was interesting because I'm not sure what year it is, what year that was, but it turned out I had already some commitments to a couple of big races. And I had called, you know, I got a call from this was Trans Am, right? I got suspended from. So yeah. I got a call from IMSA. They took it very serious. They sat down with me. They talked to me about it, and I raced. So I was able to race. I didn't race as much as I would have liked to. I would have liked to have done a couple more Trans Am races, but I got a chance to still do those other races because they had looked at the situation and they said, you know, look, everybody talks to each other in the business. It's a small business, but yeah. I got sat down by anybody I was racing for or any organization I was racing for to make sure that I was kind of like on a probationary period while I was suspended. So I had to deal with that mentally. It was hard. Yeah. You know, you talk to a lot of people, they say, oh, write this or write that or write this. And I just wrote what I thought I should write. You know, I apologize for the situation. In fact, the person that I got in contact with or the person that I had that trouble with, you know, Amy, it was Amy Ruhlman. I love her. I love her family. You know, it was a racing thing. And we've had some great battles since. I mean, I don't know what happens, but I mean, we always kind of gravitate to each other at least a few times, you know, for the year. And
Yeah, I admit.
I did some go-karting. But I did a lot of, thinking, you know, because it is an aggressive sport. It is an intense sport. And the best can come out of you in this sport and the worst can come out of you in this sport. It's the yin and yang. It is the greatest feeling that you have when things go right. And it could be your lowest low, you know. I've won races. I've been in huge accidents where, you know, it might not have been my fault or failure or stuff like that and gotten hurt really bad. So, I mean, if you're not willing to deal with all those things that can be thrown at you in racing, you think life throws stuff at you. Racing throws a lot of stuff on you, and it does it within a millisecond. Things can change.
Yeah. To be honest, that question I had to plan for because I wanted to make sure I worded it in a way that.
Oh, it's okay. Hey, you know what? I really appreciate the way you asked it. You're a class act for, not sure about asking that question, but you know, it's part of racing. I've had some great, great days, and I'm human. I make mistakes, but you know, you it's all in the recovery.
That's a good way to look at it.
All in the recovery. In racing, you got to do it. In life, it's all in recovery. It's who recovers quickest that wins.
Good to hear. Good way to look at it. And you're also a class act, in my opinion.